synthesis, but I actually like it hasn't been my primary focus really at all. Hold on, let me make sure this is all good. I only recently, I would say in the past few years, like truly started to explore the different avenues of just like learning what's going on. And funny enough, learning Serum actually really expanded just like a lot of the concepts that were maybe a little overwhelming for me to learn. 'Cause you know, I kind of come from a more like sample-based mentality, and that's why like I record my guitars and then kind of like chop them up and create new sounds and stuff like that, and same with drums and stuff, as you guys have seen. But I've always been curious about synthesis, and I actually even recently just watched the first part of this documentary that this plugin company called G-Force put out about like some of the most famous synth manufacturers. And I love stuff like that. I just think it's cool to learn about it. It's like, you know, about Bob Moog and I forget his first name, but the guy who did Buchla, and then Arp, which is another old famous synth company. And so like I like learning about it. I would say my knowledge has been more recent than other things in the synthesis world. But my goal today is to maybe like put your guys' mind at ease on certain concepts that maybe feel kind of like confusing. Because I know, I remember when I started out like looking at a mod matrix, I was like, what is going on here? Like, I just want a, you know, super saw chord sound. You know, I wasn't really like thinking about what's going on. I was more kind of focused on just getting results rather than the process. But in the past few years, I've just like had more curiosity about it, and that's probably why I got more into it. So let's go around and kind of just all talk about maybe how about like one thing you feel comfortable with, and then one thing you're more curious about and maybe want to learn about today. So we'll start with Will.
Well, I feel pretty comfortable with like wavetable synthesis. I was a Serum user for most of my synth life. Now I'm onto Diva for almost everything. I would say the thing that still boggles my mind is FM synthesis and looking at like FM8. It terrifies me.
Yeah,
No idea
FM8,
what's going on there.
it's funny because FM8, like, it's really powerful in what you can do, but the way you have to, like, learn the concepts, it's kind of, yeah, it doesn't really make sense in relation to a lot of other synths unless you're pretty, like, well-versed in FM synthesis. I can open it up. I only recently finally started to get kind of comfortable with it, but I think it's just kind of like an older interface for the same thing that maybe other plugins do a little bit more intuitively now. Yeah, I'll go into FM because I like FM, and honestly, learning through Ableton's operator is like the best way because it's like really simplified and you can hear the results very quickly. Whereas FM8, sometimes you get lost in menus and you don't really know what you're like messing with. So yeah, I'll definitely jump into FM because FM is really cool. Jeff, what about you?
So I'm pretty comfortable with Serum and Massive X. You know, usually what I'll do is download, you know, take a preset and then I start manipulating it a bit. But where I get lost sometimes is in the layering of the different sounds, figuring out, okay, now I've got one basic synth sound. What do I need to add to kind of overall enhance the music?
So kind of like expanding on more fundamental synth sounds and going into more like experimental kind of like
Yeah, so I have a, let's say I have a synth running in the background and sounding good, but now when you listen to the whole recording, I may want to enhance it, either layer a similar sound, different frequencies, and not necessarily just dropping it an octave, you know what I'm saying?
yeah, it's kind of like having supplemental kind of support for something like a synth line.
Right, and knowing when to use it and when not.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of that comes from like layering, whether it's like having a complete separate layer of like purely effects, like, you know, you could do like granular delays and stuff like that to kind of go around your ears and then still have the fundamental in the center. You can also do, yeah, I'll go into that. That's a good concept because, you know, that's like a lot of people will get all excited to like buy an analog synth and then they like plug it in and play it. And if you just play the presets on like a Juno 106, it can sound very dorky and like you can just be like, wow, I thought this was going to be some like lush, crazy thing. But if you go to like preset 13 or something, it's going to be like a little flute emulation from the 80s that's like, do, 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 do. But like the real magic of those types of synths are when you're kind of running it in a particular way through its filter, which is analog, and kind of using those elements and kind of bringing them out with other effects, whether it's like heavy compression on your computer or other effects like reverb and delay. Like when you run a Juno through reverb and delay, that's where it like really opens up. And so sometimes it's easy to think like, oh, I just have like a simple chord progression and it's fine. But if you go that tiny extra mile of adding certain effects and get creative with it, you can really bring out the best qualities of certain sounds. And even like stereo stuff, kind of like pulling out just stereo information if you want to make it a wider sound, you know, that kind of stuff. It's simple, but it makes a big difference. Miles, what about you?
Yeah, so this class is going to be great for me, I think. I've kind of dabbled with Serum a little bit, not enough, mainly because of what Stefan was mentioning before was it's a little overwhelming when there's just so many knobs and different things to choose from where, you know, the presets are fine, but like, what am I actually doing? Because turning the knobs and stuff are fine just to see what happens, but I would really like to know like what I'm doing so I can like make it a little more calculated instead of like a random fluke that something cool happens.
Yeah.
And, it'd be great because I was really looking at getting a Diva after you showed us one class and didn't pull the trigger, went up in price, and I'm a little bummed out about that. But it'd be great just to learn these different you know, aspects going forward.
Yeah. So
not really too much experience, but this should be good.
Yeah, what's cool about Diva is it combines like the best elements of probably most of the major like classic synthesizers that have ever come out. And that's why it's such a popular synth, because you can like combine the like mixing structure of a Moog with like the oscillators of a MS-20 and then have like the filter of a Juno. And so it's like it's all really subtle things that when you add up these pieces, you get kind of this really interesting tone in the end that you wouldn't have achieved with an actual analog synth. So it's I still not totally like well versed in it, but it goes back to what you're saying, just learning more and more about these concepts help understand that and even other synths, you know. And the same thing with what Will was saying about FM, like once you learn FM in a more like kind of simple sense, then other plugins that are more advanced end up feeling a little, you're like, oh, okay, that's what this is doing. It just looks different. You know, that's mostly the case. Like the main reason I bring up Serum all the time is because I don't know if there's other synths out there that do this. There probably are, but especially now, Serum was the first synth that visually showed me what was going on. Whereas like before, if I was doing a mod matrix, you would just have to know that like your LFO speeds at like a quarter note of your, you know, project's BPM and it is, you know that it's affecting your cutoff frequency, but you're not seeing it go like, you know, in quarter notes on the filter. So you're kind of just like, you have to know. And when you're still learning, stuff like that can be hard to like keep track of. And, you know, obviously when you learn more and more, it gets easier. But yeah, so that's definitely something I want to help you guys hopefully with today. Ollie, what about you?
So I think in Serum, I know how pretty much like, I know how most things, like what most things do and stuff, but I struggle to kind of implement it myself into sound design without, I don't know, just making like a boring synth or something. So I kind of know like the basics, but actually implementing that knowledge is a bit of a struggle for me.
Yeah, I feel you on that. I mean, I never really did that much sound design stuff for just like the first big part of my music life. Just because I was after sounds that like surprised me, not so much crafting it from the ground up with an idea. Like I usually didn't have an idea of what I wanted and I would kind of react to sound. So that's why I would like flip through presets and then kind of go, that's close to what I want. And then I would start to change it more. And a lot of where my sound came from, especially in the beginning of my electronic stuff, was like abusing the hell out of a source signal. And so that's why like you brought up in our Discord doing Boy and the Beast. It's like an interesting project to look at, but in reality, I was just taking, or Brendan and I were just taking presets and just like abusing them with distortion and like reverbs and then like rendering that and then copying little bits of that. I can show you, it's like interesting to see, but for the most part, it's not like creative from the ground up sound design, which is like what a lot of other people do. And I still don't really do that much crazy sound design in my like DAW producing, but what I've what's nice is by getting more into hardware, I can then use these concepts that I've learned to actually craft sound. Because it's just more fun with, if you think about like crafting a sound, for me, a big barrier to entry was just the fact that you're like using your one mouse and you have to kind of always go around to all these things. But when you're using your two hands on like a device, you get to be like, you know, twice the speed of what you would with a mouse, and also just like full tactile functionality. So I'm not saying like you have to have a real synthesizer to feel like you're making sounds, but it just, for me, made the barrier to entry a lot easier. And so that's why I've kind of gone down the rabbit hole of actual synths, because it's just fun. And I like, another thing I do is try and either look for synths that don't have presets, or ones that have them have the ability to just like my Moog Sub 37 has this function that's just called panel, which means like whatever's live on the panel, you just, that's what you're hearing. And I love going into that mode, and like usually the first sound is the weirdest thing ever, because it's all in just random positions, and then you kind of have to like craft it to something. And even then, I don't have like a sound in mind. I'm usually just kind of experimenting. And so yeah, the same concepts can be brought to any of these plugins. Richard, what about you?
Yeah, you guys all pretty well said it, but I'm at the point where like I don't think I'll ever be able to really just like take a initial, you know, nothing on it preset, not preset, but nothing on it synth, and then just, you know, start by tweaking the entire thing, create the whole thing myself. Like, I don't think I'll be at that point really ever. I just work with presets right now, and I manipulate them a little bit. And
I'm don't say to ever.
Oh, maybe one day. I don't know. I just can't be bothered to right now either. It's like, I like finding the base of what I think is sounds good, and then tweaking it a bit. I'm learning a lot about like the effects. I don't know. Do you prefer to use external, you know, other plugins, or do you use the plugins like in the built into the actual synth?
That's actually a great question.
Serum has some like really cool like hyperdimension and all that stuff, but
yeah, it really depends on the synth. Like, I think I have a strange kind of predisposition to always bypass the effects that are on the synth, except for Serum, just because they work so well in tandem with the synth. And also, there's even like, you can get a standalone Serum effects and put it on any synth, which is really cool. If you own Serum, yeah, you can also get that.
That's cool.
Yeah.
And so, I don't mind some of them.
Yeah. I mean, they're just like creative and well done. But I think I prefer always to do external plugins, just because of the like ease of which you can do like send and returns and like bypass really quickly and know exactly what's turning on and off. And I think I just like got so used to like Silenth and Nexus's effects being so not dope sounding that I would just like always instantly turn them off. And sometimes they're good. It just depends on how they're dialed in. But like, for the most part, I'm always just kind of like, nope, turn that off, turn off. And like, I like what I was saying to Jeff is like, I like that mentality of like, when you do get an old analog synth and you play it and it's very strong sounding, but you kind of have to keep crafting it to get something a bit more interesting than just like a, you know. And so yeah, I'm just used to using other effects, and I've just collected effects over the years that I know and like and are usually more interesting than like the plugins, built-in ones. But Serum is a good example of a good one, especially because it works. I think the reason the Serum effects are so key are the fact that they work exactly like everything else on the plugin. You know what I mean? You can be modulating an echo time the same way that you're modulating your cutoff time, you know what I mean? Or your cutoff filter. And so it's like that integration is what makes it key. You know, you can just have like little effects come in with LFOs or envelopes, and that's pretty dope. Okay, so I think today I will start by just kind of like doing a general overview of concepts, and then I'm gonna use Serum a lot just because of how visual it is, and they really have a lot of these topics, but and remind me again how many, like just by show of hands, how many Ableton and how many Logic first Ableton? Okay, so 3 versus 2. I don't remember what Casper uses, but okay. So I'm going to start on Ableton. The thing is, I don't know if I'm going to go to Logic, just because Ableton stock synths are just really easy to use, and visually they're very nice. So I'm just going to kind of try to hopefully explain you guys concepts through that, and you'll like Logic guys will be okay. But maybe I'll go into Logic when it comes to like resampling, because I do like resampling Logic. I don't know. I'll try to do both if I can, but I'm going to start in Ableton for sure. So I just had Wavetable pulled up because I wanted to see if the stereo audio works. And if there are any people on the Twitch, I don't even know if this sounds like stereo. Somehow let us know. That'd be really nice. Because I hope that it is stereo. So I think the best place to start is by just going to some of the plugins. And the instruments. So in Ableton, the stock synths are... There's a lot of like kind of interesting, more like conceptual ones. Like I think Collision is like a kind of string or like mallet synth, which is dope, but you know, it's a more esoteric, I guess, type of synthesis versus like Analog is their like standard analog subtractive synth. So it's like two oscillators, two filters and two amps, which is really cool. So the fact that they have two filters and two amp envelopes is actually really cool, and you can get pretty creative with it. But if you want to just use like one oscillator, one filter, one amp, you know, it's just your standard like analog sounding synth. So I'll keep that up. I'm going to put up Operator, and then I'm also going to put up Wavetable, because these are like probably the three most common synths that people in electronic music are using. And so Analog is, like I said, an analog modeled synth. Operator is a FM synth, and Wavetable is a Wavetable synthesizer. So most analog, like just typical analog synths that you can think of, whether it's like a Moog or some sort of Roland synth, or you know, just kind of these like big name ones, are, we've gone over this, but they're called what's subtractive synthesis, which is like having oscillators, having a filter that kind of shapes the sound, and then an amp envelope that tells when the sound to go on and off. So it's like a very simple concept of like oscillator source, something that subtracts the sound and then amplifies it. Operator is FM, or I believe you can call FM also additive synthesis, which is the process. There is a filter, so there is a subtractive section, but the way that you shape the oscillators, or the way that you shape just the sound, is by manipulation of oscillators working either with each other or like parallel with each other in various combinations. So like, you know, when we have analog and we have two voices, they're kind of just mixed by volume. So like if we have, let me go back to analog. You know, we have the first oscillator, and then I believe we just have to turn these on to hear the second one. So if I want to like lower this an octave, so they're just mixing together, and there is some like form of, I wouldn't call it FM synth, but they kind of like work with each other. You know what I mean? That's why like when you get these, like if you go up a certain semitone, maybe like seven or something, you get these harmonics because they're two waveforms working with each other, but they're, it's not as, not as versatile as what you can do with an FM synth. And I think that comes from the fact that a lot of FM, like the interesting part of FM is what you can do with envelopes of this, the oscillators that you're having work with each other. But we'll jump into that, you know, in a bit. So I think what's cool with analog is you can have oscillator one, and then I think if I bypass filter two and amp two, so now they're both going through filter one and amp one. And you, there is a way to see, yeah, quick routing. So it looks like it says oscillator, filter, amp, just separate. So if I did that, you know, that turns these filters back on. So whenever you see these types of boxes, like you'll see this a lot with FM synths, all this means is what is the signal chain of the parts of this synthesizer, like what's happening. So when you see O, F, and A, that means oscillator, filter, amp. And with this synth, it's really simple because it's just like oscillator one, filter one, amp one. That's one pathway of sound. And then in parallel, which means unaffected from each other, it's oscillator, filter, amp. And these are just quick routing, so you can just go boom and do what I just did before, or boom and have oscillator one going into filter one, oscillator two going into filter two, but only going into one amp. So they're both just going into a single amp. But you could do this by hand and just kind of customize whatever way you want. And this is cool because, you know, like say you have both amps on, you can pan them left and right hard. So like I could have, can get really interesting stereo stuff by having just two different, you know, if I go even more exaggerated, like. And you can be, you know, like adjusting, So with amp, it's cool because you have these two signal paths that can just be independent of each other or interacting with each other. And so the reason why I like using Ableton stock plugins is they showcase all of the concepts of most synthesis in just like a really straightforward way where you don't have to like go into some separate part of the plugin. It's just like all there. And I'm sure this is a very simple concept for you guys, right? Just standard sense of just oscillator, some sort of wave shape, whether it's a sine wave or a triangle wave or sawtooth and square, and then, you know, sample and hold is usually like noise or something. Yeah, so that's noise. Or some type of kind of noise, because they have a noise oscillator, but usually you call that sample and hold, which is kind of just like random waveforms. So yeah, that's, you know, pretty basic, just like. And so if I were to pull up Diva for the non-Ableton users, that this concept would be represented by, you know, it, as you can see with analog, two oscillators, two filters, two amps. Diva would probably have one filter, one amp. I don't know if you can do two filters. I could be wrong. So right here we have three oscillators. And usually most synths, like subtractive synths, work from left to right. So typically you'll have your sound sources on the left, then this is like the volume of the like raw waveforms. So you can mix them before they get to the filter. Then it's filter, and then it's how that sound is going to be told how to be turned on and off after the filter. And so, you know, you have three oscillators that you can adjust, you know, pitch, standard stuff. These are not on. Turn off the reverb. So, you know, this is just like a standard, like this is modeled after a Moog Model D, which is like a three oscillator with one filter, which is called like a ladder filter, which was like Moog's specialty type of filter. And, you know, there's all this emphasis is like resonance. That's the other thing that it can be irritating with learning synthesis is some companies have different names for the same thing, so you can kind of like get thrown off when you see emphasis, but that just means like, if you think about it, resonance is like a resonant peak frequency on a filter, and in this case that means emphasizing a certain frequency. So where, how much emphasis do you want on the cutoff frequency, you know what I mean? But like, for example, I actually always forget where the amount of like filter envelope is it?
If you click on lag, say,
yeah,
and then go to envelope 2.
Oh, so it's just hiding in there.
Yeah.
So yeah, so I don't even know Diva that well because I constantly just am like, oh, I guess there's a... but what's cool is when you learn these concepts on something like analog and you're like, okay, filters, resonance, all this stuff, you can go to Diva and they have much more for you to choose from. So like this knob can be assigned to either envelopes. And so Will, when you adjust stuff like this, like say you want your envelope to like this, you can just go to something else and it just stays where it was, right? So like if I go, like maybe if I go to, let's see, envelope 1. No, it looks like it just is this knob and whatever.
Yeah, I would just, if you want to use two, yeah, use either side. I don't think you get that option, unfortunately.
Yeah. So this is like the volume envelope and the filter envelope both doing separate things, which is kind of cool. You can get pretty interesting sounds with one filter with, you know. So... But the cool thing with Diva is you can go from, as you see, it says VCF, which is voltage controlled filter, which is just the old school way of saying filter. And you can go from ladder, which is Moog, to cascade, which I believe is like a Roland filter. can you still see you have envelope one, envelope two? And then like this has an FM section. So what that's doing is, so when you see FM on a filter, that means that it's adding a synth frequency into the filter. Like not, it's not affecting oscillators, it's affecting the filter, which is really cool because you can get like, so say we use FM from oscillator one on the cutoff. If I change the waveform to like a square, and I can mute oscillator one so you don't hear it. And let me turn off that FM. It suddenly gets a little, it just adds extra like grit. And these are little things that you learn about shaping sound. Like one of my favorite sounds is doing filter FM from a noise oscillator. So like maybe I can change this to something with noise. So oscillator one. Yeah, so. So here it goes from just a standard synth that's like with a filter envelope and noise going through it. But if you start adding FM from oscillator one, it starts to frequency modulate the cutoff filter. And when you have a high resonance, you can get pretty cool, especially like at low. And that's how you get those kind of like wobbly, bubbly sounds. Because basically a noise oscillator is modulating that cutoff filter, which is really cool. But there's also forms of FM that you can do, I think, to just the oscillators. I think these lag, multiply, quantize. See, I'm not that well versed in Diva, so I'm learning with you guys. Oh, I think this just affects maybe what's going on here. I don't know. Anyways, I can keep kind of going through some of these, but I want to keep using the Ableton ones because they're a lot easier for both you and I to conceptualize. So if we're going to talk about FM, we can start talking a little bit about operators. So the main concept that goes with FM is routing. Like it's you know, routing on an analog modeled synth like this, it's important obviously because you can get pretty different qualities to the, like you saw I was doing like the panning left and right on the different amp. Like you can just do little nice subtle things, but with FM synths, the routing is really important because it is like, that's what the whole concept is. So if you see this chain, it's saying like D goes into C, goes into B, which goes into A. And so A is what's being fed into the amp. So like, that's what you're hearing is, they call it operator A, but you can just call it like oscillator A. It's just the old school terms for it. So when you see this straight line, it just means that every operator is feeding into the next. So like when I play it, it's going to be a sine wave because it's just. So we have a sine wave. We can change that to, you know, a square like this. Let's change it to a saw. What's cool about operators, you can draw in any waveform that you want. Because you see how it starts to change in this little window. Because basically all of these major types of waveforms are just like mathematically configured, like look, I'll go to like a square 64 and you see it's like this kind of what is it, like a logarithmic curve but equal spaced harmonics. And then ultimately the, I can also put let me get one of these up, oscilloscope. I don't remember which one's a good one, but I'll try this. So as you can see, it's like a square with like a little, that I'm sure that's what this curve is affecting, you know? But if we go to like a square 8, you can see that it's different on this oscilloscope. Or let's see, like a saw. a saw is all of these at full volume, no harmonics missing. And so if you start subtracting little things, you start gently changing the waveform, and maybe we go like this, ready? So you can get really interesting waveforms, but that's not where like FM becomes super powerful. Like the real power in FM comes from, like, you can have something as simple as a sine wave, which is just one harmonic. And you can add like maybe an extra if you really want, but have you ever like heard the series of harmonics? It goes kind of like, if you've ever played like a brass instrument or anything that multiplies harmonically, you'll hear this like series of harmonics, which is like, so that you're like, ooh, nice. But then when you get to the next one, oop, missed one. So that's just like the series of natural harmonics in like nature, like the nature of sound, how they multiply on top of each other. And when you're messing with these types of things, that like a lot of the most kind of prolific sound design guys use FM synths a lot because of the way that you can manipulate harmonics. So like, I'll just kind of give you a quick crash course on why I use operator for like interesting sounds. So you go like this. First off, turn up tone, because that just unleashes the, I guess, the full potential of the plugin. So let's make, I'll just show you a simple concept. Let's just do like a saw. I have my sine on operator A, which is going directly to the amp. So you're hearing that. When I start to dial in a sawtooth, listen what happens. Do you hear how it starts to overpower the sine and starts to kind of shape the waveform? And you can even look on the oscilloscope, ready? See how that, you can see a little tiny saw in the signal path of that sine wave. And then when you're full volume like this, you can see that it's like a combination of a sine wave and a sawtooth. So if I take like an LFO and turn this on, let me make the destination be just B. Right now I have like, you know, a simple sine wave with a, you guys know what an LFO is, right? It's a low frequency oscillator, which is basically back in the day when you wanted something to slowly modulate, you used like an oscillator on your synth on a low frequency mode. So it was very slow. Like if you listen to it, it would just be like, but you could use that and manipulate things like filters or, you know, levels of sound, you know what I mean? It's just it was a tool. So we're taking LFO. So let me quickly show you the difference between, so do you hear that? So I told you guys FM is all about routing. So this four boxes with a little down means every operator is independently going to the amp without affecting each other. So like level, you know, minus 34 decibels and 12 decibels are both hitting the amp on envelope. So if I press a key, you hear a pitch, the pitch being modulated by the LFO of operator B and then just A going. But when you put them one after another, it starts to affect the actual harmonic content. And so let me see, because I didn't even mean to put the LFO on the pitch. I meant to put it on the volume. So you can go like this. I think destination A is hardwired to pitch. So if I were to go, it's just pitch. There also is filter, which is nice. So you can be like, you know, LFO the filter, but I'm gonna go volume of oscillator B. And let me kind of you hear how we're starting to get these kind of interesting harmonic qualities because you're running oscillators into each other and kind of shaping that sound. So let me see if I can, yeah. So watch when I change the pathway. And listen, it just sounds much different. And then you can also do things like when you go into each operator, you can change like the attack. So it's like, and you also, sometimes you don't actually even have to hear it, but I don't know if you can do that on this. Let me see something. And you can start messing with this more. You start opening up the capabilities of so all like it can seem kind of like mysterious and kind of ridiculous, but all you're doing is just putting waveforms together to create new harmonics. That's what FM is. And you can get like crazy with this concept and have, you know, four operators going of different, like I can go into, you know, a square and kind of maybe take away something and go, and then these fine tune is like where you get into. So coarse tuning is basically what I was doing here, going up the harmonic series. So I can go like, and all these do is just like add different kind of timbre in the harmonics. So you can have just like a little, if I take that away, it doesn't have that bright top, but you're not hearing the individual tone. You're hearing it affect the signal path of all of these operators. So if I go back to this equal routing, that's what it sounds like. So you hear the difference, obviously, between that and, right? And do you guys get this? Am I going like really fast and it's like weird and, or is it boring? Like, is this interesting? Is it helping the concepts of FM? Like, feel free to ask questions because I still don't, I'm not like some expert. I just know some things about it. And I know like, Will, this was definitely your, question of the day, so I'm definitely curious to hear what you think.
Yeah, honestly, one thing that I keep on thinking is I wish I could use operator in Logic because it seems so much more manageable than FM8.
Yeah, so let me pull up FM8 and just see if I can kind of explain these similar concepts, because I'm not even that good at FM8, but I kind of understand it a bit more now. It's all the same concept, but it's just a lot more options and kind of workaround. So if I start off with FM8 in the same way that we did with operator, we have a sine wave. So these are all just like browser stuff. Master is kind of like just like your amp, you know, end master amp stuff, whether it's like voices and detune and all that. Effects is effects. So really what you want to look at is, I mean, honestly, I'm pretty sure the only setting that matters for doing what I was just doing is this expert section. And so what you have is, so you see this concept, it's, this is what we were just doing. This is the routing of like operator. So it's the same concept, just in a different map. And it's actually more versatile because these are what's called FM algorithms, which means just like a set routing of signal, you know? And in this case, this is like D through C through B through A. This is D and C equally going into B and A. This is D going through C, which is then being equally put through A. So it's like all, if I play it for you, sorry, let me go back to operator. Oh, I don't have much going on in C and D, so let me just see. Let me like, okay, so ready? Here, even just that is a subtle change. And then, that's sick. And all I'm doing is changing the order in which these are working with each other. And I'm not even doing that much crazy stuff FM-wise. Like these two are just tones that are adding to the signal path. And the reason FM sounds so like kind of like robotic sometimes is because like in this case, I have the coarse pitch, which is like that series of harmonics on 16, which is just like an arbitrary number in that harmonic order, that's just adding this like overtone that I'm trying to think if there's like an analogy in the real world that you can apply this to. Because it's not adding new sound, it's adding to the existing sound by interfering with this kind of pathway of waveforms, if that makes sense. And that's why it's called frequency modulation. You're modulating the frequency with other frequencies. So, and then this is all of them playing, not modulating each other. So, full on, nothing. These are like the individual ingredients, and then this is all of them working into each other, which is really cool. But FM8, it's the same concept. You have operator A, B, C, D, E, and F. So F is going into the master at 80% apparently. Oh, sorry, I'm still playing. So if I lower this, I believe it's just volume. Yeah, amplitude. So we have a sine wave. If we just take A, you can go A into F 100%, and you're getting two sine waves apparently. Let me see if I can change this to a sawtooth. See, this is where
I have to click A on. Just click on that. Yeah.
There's an on button?
I think it's control click.
See, this is where it gets. Yeah. I haven't actually used FM8 that much. I just kind of understand it based on FM. So, same concept. You're sending a sawtooth into a sine wave. And then you can, I imagine. Let's see. You can say amp mod, so I could say, like, let's modulate the amp by the LFO. Let's see what happens. Same concept as we were just doing. I can lower the ratio. And then what's cool about FM8 is you can do these things like feedback. Like, so now I'm feeding back a sine into itself. So you could be doing that. And all of a sudden, you're just like in a new territory. So that's where it's like a lot more advanced. And maybe you can do that stuff in operator. I don't really know. But yeah, all that FM synthesis is just operators manipulating each other or themselves. And so like you could take A, and then instead of A going right to F, you can have A go to B, which then goes to F. So it's just a map. So I'll turn on B like you just taught me. I'll change this to like maybe a TX wave, whatever that is. And maybe I'll even lower. So then when you go in, like now that we have an LFO set, I don't know where LFO 1 is, so we have to probably find that. Probably in mod? No. Oh yeah. So LFO 1, we can lower the rate. Oh wow, and this is just like a little mod. So these are all just matrixes. So this is the mod matrix where you can adjust how much LFO, where it's going from. So you can go from LFO, maybe let's go to F as well. Or maybe we want to do like, can you do like filter stuff? Hold on. So you have control 1, maybe you set control as, oh, interesting. So you have X and Y, you can have like these set. Can you like change these? See, this is where I don't actually know that much about FM8, but basically the main concepts of FM synths are just here where you're routing operators to work with each other, and whatever you want to do with that is up to you. And I think you can save little map kind of, you know, pathways, which is really cool. But like what you're seeing here, this like series of an order is, oh whoops, don't record, is the same thing as this. You can just customize it in whatever way you want. And like if this had the like feedback into itself, you would see that arrow up and around, and maybe you can do it in another part of the menu, but I don't know. So yeah, I'm not an expert in FM8 at all, but if you learn these concepts and like learn these little things like turning on the operator. I, you know, didn't know that because I've clearly never really used it. And, you know, these things like ratio and offset, that's the same thing as coarse and fine tune, I believe. It's, let's see. Yeah, it's just the pitch in equal parts, or this probably the 0.8 is in like fine tune. No, I don't mean to do that. So you can start getting really rich harmonic stuff, which is cool. And then what you do with that is up to you. So like, let me go back to operator because it's a little easier. So we have this crazy sound, and Richard brought up Serum. So let me show you one of the benefits of having Serum is using Serum effects. So you can then be using like what you were saying, like the hyper dimension stuff, you know, and it's like, so all of a sudden you get into like, let me see, like, oh Jesus, sorry. And what the cool thing about Serum is the fact that you can reorder stuff really quickly. Like if you want to distort your hyper dimension, which is like not usually recommended, but it sounds cool, so why not? And then you can multiband compress that. So all of a sudden you have something that sounded like this. And if all you do is like adjust these things, if you're like after just crazy sounds, all you really need to do is take a solid FM synth like operator, or if you learn FM8 more and just run it through some crazy effects, you're golden. Because without that, it sounds like this. All that, like, it honestly goes back to what we were talking about with Jeff. It's like you have an analog synthesizer, and the beauty of analog waveforms is that they have things like analog summing, just like clipping or some sort of like distortion in signal based on the fact that it's going through an analog circuit. So that can be like exploited with effects, you know what I mean? And same with filters. Like filters resonate at a certain, or they have kind of like different resonant characteristics depending on what type of filter it is. And if you push that, you get really cool sounds. And so the same thing goes for operator or just FM synth, is like when you create these harmonically rich waveforms like this, you can see there's a lot of stuff going on in that. So you can pull it out with things like multiband compression or distortion. And all of a sudden you got that, you know? And I think if you, like if I were to do like a progression, what note am I playing? Why can't I see? C1, okay. So imagine, oh, I'm doing an FM8, that's why I'm not seeing it. Sometimes I'm a goof. So say I do a progression like that. I actually forget, there's a way you have to like route something so that the LFOs work in time with your projects, so that your, like, let me see if I were to just do like, yeah, I forget how you do this. I think
if you click off on mode,
no, there's something, because it's not working, I don't think, right? I watched some video on it once because I was like running into this problem where it basically, you have to like route something to it so that it thinks that it's being played. I forget how. But there is a way to unlock the capabilities of like LFOs and stuff going on with, you know, you can modulate all of these little functions in, how do you do this again? Maybe you go.
Could it be in
Glow? Yeah, what I've done in the past is I've put another track that just has MIDI and routed that MIDI to it. So same MIDI clip MIDI in too. A separate track.
And then you go moderator or operator, and then Serum effects. Oh, I probably have to play the other clip. That would work. Oh yeah, now it's working. Sorry for this ridiculous progression, but I wanted to go like, oh boy. But so this is where sound design gets fun, because you just get to kind of like mess around with all these little tools. And that's why I like Serum for the limited knowledge that I have of it, is that you can just keep kind of clicking around, and visually it's a lot.
This is a super basic question.
Yeah.
Is there an undo in Serum?
I think, I don't know. Let me see. No, because usually if I press Control Z or Command Z, it would just take off the plugin.
That's
I'm oh no! Just... Look,
it's working.
Yeah, look. But it looks like it's only one.
Is it just the one?
Because now I'm like taking away the MIDI. I think that I just did. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Interesting.
I'm so scared of changing to new sounds because that might.
Well, you know, you can always do is
duplicate.
Just, yeah, duplicate, mute it. It just might kill your CPU, but. Yeah, so that's how you get Serum to work, I guess, with MIDI. I've never clearly done it. It's funny. Sometimes I teach you guys concepts that like I never even use because I'm just like focused on other things. But I like to be able to try it and give you some knowledge on it if it makes you guys excited. But yeah, this is why FM synthesis can be pretty cool, because you could learn all these concepts of operator and you're still kind of stuck with a sound like this. And you can use like, you know, I could take audio effects from Ableton. Like I could take like... dynamic tube. Let's see what that sounds like. Not output. I don't know why I use dynamic tube. I don't even use dynamic tube. I'm gonna use saturation. You know, and go to like wave shaper. You start getting some nice distortion. So this is just distorting those harmonics, which is really nice. And you could put that through like amp, and then you get just like a weird convolution type thing. So let's see. It doesn't have to be Serum effects. Oh geez, sorry. I guess amp isn't the, no, it'd be cabinet that's the convolution. Now it sounds like a guitar, which is kind of cool. And if you think about it, a guitar is a very harmonically rich signal. You know, that's why you get these like cool feedback-y type overtone-y sounds when you play guitar. That's pretty cool. And then you could, you know, OTT it, because why not? Let's see what happens. And it's just going to bring out like the a little bit of spiciness. But if we had like some reverb before, like a Psycho. If you do like a short. So this is just where like sound design gets fun, because you're just kind of like experimenting with what you have available. And like, you know, Serum does make it a lot easier by just being like an all-in-one effects unit. Like this. I mean, honestly, I would say like probably the instant like sound good effect is like doing these kind of like dimension type stuff. Because it just gives you a stereo feeling. And I don't even know if it's like great for mono compatibility, but you can always put like an envelope on it or an LFO so that it is mono at the beginning and then kind of gradually gets stereo. Like you could do envelope 2, go down, and then have like a, but that's of course, oh, I have to have it playing. Where are you? Oh, God, it's the other MIDI clip. Oh, I have still something else going through. I don't know what it is. Oh, this dimension. So like these both are getting modulated, which is kind of cool in a, let me go back. So So yeah, it's just whatever you decide to use, whether it's Serum or Ableton stock plugins, you can get pretty interesting stuff. I also forgot to turn these off, apparently. And I can go more into FM synths, but like, really, if you just nail these concepts of what's going on here, the rest is really up to your own creativity, because you can just keep going from this to then different algorithms. And maybe I take this down now. So here it's just all harmonics. And so like I can now mess with like the envelope of... So now when you have all that rich harmonic content, and then you go back to Serum. Oh, we have Serum on. And you can literally just like... And then if you have something like the Max for Live LFO, you can just do stuff more, even more visually. Like I can be mapping this like this and be like, this is great for like creating effects. If you need a build. And then this is just like another form of FM, just being like, so yeah, the sky is the limit with this kind of stuff. And that's probably why it can be like, you know, I never really learned FM8, but it's just because you can do so much stuff to this signal, as I've already done. But that's like kind of sweet. And then what's really dope is you can get the kind of like for example, I always loved in old rave tunes, they had like the kind of re-spaces that would go at different frequencies based on the note you're pressing. And I think that has either has to do with resampling the sound, or something like this where the actual waveform itself is like affecting something else, so you get this different kind of beating, and that's pretty cool. I gotta really learn this more. I mean, I think Will basically just told me the most basic tip for it, which is just turning on. Oh, you can do it with left click too. And then when you dive in more to like the individual operators and in this, I mean, yeah, it is like the same thing as operator on Ableton. It's just more options. Will, do you feel better about using this now? If you're still
I here. Do. I gotta say the tip on just using effects has opened it up greatly, because it sounds so cheesy in 80s normally, and now it sounds like a modern D&B sound.
Yeah, I mean a lot of the most kind of champion sound design guys do a lot of FM stuff. And Wavetable obviously has kind of opened up a lot since FM, but there's the key with FM is the fact that it's harmonically rich, and like what you're doing is just either adding or manipulating harmonics. And so when you take those harmonics and do something else with it, it's the same thing as plugging like a guitar into an amplifier. Like you're pushing this signal in a way that adds really nice life and character. So I'm sure even like the effects on FM8 are dope. I just have never even tried them. Like, that's kind of cool. Literally sounds like a guitar. I don't even know if this X is done. say like D, and I don't even know what. Oh yeah, because I took D and made it a short. It's even that, like, you can send D back into C. So you're just creating complex algorithm, which is really cool. And if I turn these effects off, it's going to sound probably kind of just, like, aggressive, but where it really comes in to creativity is the effects after. And then you could just, like, layer a sub underneath that, you know what I mean? And you have something pretty cool. Cool. So I guess we've covered, I mean, Wavetable. So I like Ableton's Wavetable because it takes the concepts of Serum and makes it really accessible and just like easy. So like, you know, you have your basic Wavetable, which is morphing from a sine wave to a triangle to a saw to a square. So it's just, and you might think that it kind of feels similar to FM, but the reality is it's like FM if you can keep changing the, like, because you can do frequency modulation within a wavetable synth, but possibilities open up because you have the frequencies that you're either modulating or using to modulate can then change within themselves. Does that make sense? Based on what you guys learned with FM synth, it's like you then have like a tangible form of FM. And so I imagine, I actually don't know if Wavetable is capable of FM. I've never tried. It says FM. Well, so this is just showing like what happens to a waveform during an FM folding. But I would imagine in the matrix you could maybe go like, because it's two oscillators, so let's see. Once again, I'm hitting you guys with stuff that I've never actually done anything with, so. I don't know. But for the concepts of wave tables, I will show you guys what you can really do with this. So let's see, like, we'll just do this FM one just for fun. But what I like about FM or wavetable is you see how I'm moving this and you see oscillator one position here. So if you just want to assign it to an envelope, you just go boom. And then you can look at your envelope. And that's usually mod sources. So envelope two, I can go like slow attack. And you see it moving. And then it's going to go down. And you see how it went down halfway and then it went down all the way because that's what this envelope is, you know, reflecting. So you can do, you know, whatever you want. You could say oscillator position go from envelope but also be affected by the LFO. So the initial hit will go of the envelope and then after that it'll keep being affected by the LFO, which is cool. You could do the pitch like that. You can do anything you want. So whatever you click on is usually what is able, like you can click on this and that's the gain of the oscillator. Or you can have a sub. And you can have the sub's gain just being modulated by the LFO. If you wanted that. So it just makes a mod matrix really straightforward because you click on the thing, it shows up and it shows you the options that you have to modulate. And it's not that many things. Like you can modulate by the envelopes, the amp, the LFOs, and I don't know if you can add more. And clearly there's MIDI modulation. I don't really know what you can do with that. But that's cool too, I guess. Oh, this is for stuff like velocity. Like you can have the velocity affect your amp based on how you hit it and things like aftertouch, which is like when you push down keys further and all that. I never really use this. Random might be cool for whatever that is, but yeah, and so then you can filter this stuff. But really where like the basics of wavetables and like where you're gonna get interesting stuff is by finding these little patches of sound in the wavetable itself. So like you, I think you can also, similar to convolution reverb, you can just drag in sounds. So like, so that just made a wavetable based off of that thing. Let me turn off oscillator too. Is there a way to like reset the matrix? I think you can just double click everything. So let's see if there's like a, that'll be cool. Let's see. So you hear that. It's taking cycles of the waveform and creating like a digital waveform recreation of that. So when you cycle through it, you get that sound, but you're able to mess with it. Oh, and I have the sub going. That's why you hear that. But if you pause on like a certain section, you're getting all these interesting little waveforms. So it sometimes sounds like FM, but it's really just like recreating what FM, what you can get with FM. You know what I mean? Like, I'm sure there's some sort of like wave, additive waveform kind of stuff going on in this moment of that cycle. But what's nice is you can like freeze it and mess with just these little parts. And so you can even do like bizarre stuff. Like, let's see what happens when you do a guitar chord. So you start to get these cool harmonics. And if I played that low, and if I were to just like maybe, and like, let me change the tunes. So this is just like the simple stuff you can do with a wavetable, like this, you know, series of cycles of a waveform, and then how you manipulate it is up to you. So like I'm doing like an LFO modulation of the position, but with like a sample and hold source, which is just like a basically random values. And if you change like the starting point, you know what I mean, it's only going to jump around this section, but if you go up here, it's going to jump around this section, based on how much you add, you know, 50 or 100 or just a little. And then if you add things like filter, you can even do, I wonder if you can even, it'd be sweet if you can modulate the, so I was able to actually do that. Let me go back. So if I go here and click rate, can I then go? So cool, yeah, you can modulate like the LFO with the second LFO. Like if I take this and go slower and go. So these are just like, I'm just kind of showing you like the potentials of what you can do with a matrix. The one kind of downside with this like click to discover what you can modulate is when you start off with like a standard wavetable, come on, you have like three options, and then no matter what you click, it starts to show you what you're able to modulate, which is nice because it's simpler, but sometimes having that, like in Devo where you have the full list of what you can do, you can kind of just like dial in exactly what you're trying to do. I would say this is a bit more, oh, that's weird, it didn't reset. Yeah, see what I mean? It's just amp, pitch, and oscillator one position. But the more you click, you know, you can go frequency and it starts adding frequency. You can add resonance, it starts adding resonance. But I guess if you don't touch it, it just goes back, which is kind of nice. I love how I'm giving you guys a class where I'm like learning these synths with you guys. And then, you know, Serum takes all that and kind of adds more and can flip it on its head a little bit. I'm sure you guys have used it quite a bit. Oh, crap. So you got your sources. So, like, you know, you can do analog sources. You have your wavetable position. You guys know all this stuff. You put an LFO on it. It starts shaking it around. But what's cool is, like, you can go, say, like this. Actually sounds kind of sick. You can then go into this whole section, which is modulation. It's just like how you can mess with the waveform itself on the oscillator. So like I can go, a really common one is FM from B. So that's taking frequency modulation from oscillator B. You can take the volume down and then all of a sudden you're throwing a sawtooth into this wavetable. If I like... getting all those complex harmonics, you know? So if I, like... The most apparent is when you have, like, say, like, the sine one, basic sine. Where is it? Maybe just basic shapes. See, this one doesn't have cycles, but... Wow! So you start getting FM tones, you know? And if you, like, yeah, say, like, an acid waveform. And you can, you know, put an LFO on that. What's cool is you can just keep flipping through these different... No, I don't want that. How do you remove... Yeah. But then, you know, I'm sure you guys have gone through these options, like these, all these little functions. I mean, you could, I wonder if you can just go like, let's see, bend this one. If I were to like also modulate that while it's FMing. Cool. Or if you did it from like a different LFO at a different rate and like a different start point. Where's phase? I guess you could just flip this and then it's a different phase. And this is still just like, you know, the oscillator sources. You start adding filters and stuff like that, you can, you know, just do the same. And, you know, all you're doing is creating complex waveforms that then you can add crazy effects to. What's sick about Serum is then, like, you don't just have filters, you have like these bizarre, like, I know a lot of people use this reverb filter. It sounds ridiculous, but all of a sudden, you're just in new territory. Just add a kick and a snare, and you're basically like on your way to the festival, you know? Is this like new to any of you guys, or you guys know all this stuff already? Does it make sense? Or am I just kind of like zipping through and you guys aren't able to like figure out what I'm doing?
I think it's good. This is exactly what I wanted. Yeah.
All right, cool. Yeah. I mean, man, like it's funny because I would say Serum is the best synth to start. Like if you don't really know what's going on synthesis wise and just start like clicking stuff and like looking it up. Like for example, this like bend, you're like, what is it bending? And then you can start kind of seeing it's bending the waveform in a certain way. So like you turn this down, it's not bending it. You turn all the way up, it's bending it. So like maybe there's a different position in this that you can look at. So it's going like this, it's stretching it this way and creating just a different timbre. And so you can go from bend to like this I think this is like an asymmetrical pushing it one way. And then if you go minus, it's pushing it the other way. And so like if this was a more complex waveform, like let me go to like spectral or something. Jesus, sorry. And with this type of stuff, like all these like really complex waveforms, the subtle, like only a little bit of FM is where you get really cool stuff. I want reverb again. Pretty cool. And rearranging stuff, like you can get just like interesting, like that metallic sound. Like if I were to make like a little like, let's see, like if I were to go, what is it, 140 is like the dubstep tempo. And like just take like a kick and a snare, especially like a drum and bass one, or even if, actually I'll just take up a straight up drum and bass loop, like I usually have like 174. Yeah, and we go into like, hold on, let me just make this slightly more, why does it not quantize? 16 notes. I'm just gonna go like this, and then go one. And if this is the type of music you want to make, you can just start kind of. Perfect. This is where it gets fun. And thankfully in drum and bass, you can like sidechain to like the entire kick and snare. So you can just be like, maybe too much. And if you wanted, you could just be like going in this mode and recording this. Oh, crud. All of those little automation changes, like even within effects and stuff. So let me like just go like this. And I forget if you, I think you have to just put this on to record. And if I turn off the record like this, yeah. So if I go like this, I believe, and I have automation open. Let's just see like so we can see. And if I go record, sick. Oh, I was over here. All right. come back in. So like you could do that, have all that automation saved. Actually, I literally want to do that and then go. And then if you wanted, maybe you could go like and have a few different varieties of patterns. Be like, so let's see what that would sound like if that was on like the fourth. Oh crud. Ah, come on. Here we go. So like imagine it's. Then you could be like octave up. It sounds ridiculous, but you can even go like longer versions. So like all these little subtle things. If you were to make like a loop of this, and say you like that automation data, I'm pretty sure you can. I wonder if I copy it there and paste it here, does it do all of the things that I've just done? No, it just is each. Does anyone know that in Ableton? Like if you can copy all automation, like say I just wanted like everything I did on every lane, I would probably honestly just have to like show automated parameters only. Oh, but that's within this. I could go like and add.
Yeah, lanes. I think you have to show all of the lanes and then you can highlight and do it.
And you would just have to go one by one like I'm doing.
That so just like, blew my mind. I did not know you could show all the lanes.
So if I wanted all that stuff, and I can just copy it and put it over here. I mean, the other really key thing is, I wonder if you can see it in the clip view? Yeah, like if you were to, I don't really know how to differentiate from recording automation like live on the arrangement or in clip view. I wonder if that's if you're going in here. Ooh, okay. We're gonna learn stuff together. So if I go back here and I go, if I record, I wonder if now that is that live in this? Show all envelopes, come on, please. And that'd be dope, but if you do stuff like this, you know, it's copied on each clip, which is really nice. So if I go through all these things like filter cutoff, this is probably a smarter way of doing what I was just showing you guys. Because every time it's going to repeat, and then you can just take that clip and like drag it in, and then that one has all this automation data on it. There'd be a really cool way if you could just like go in here and say like you like this section. Actually, I don't know. If you could like just drag it over and then it would be baked into the clip. But I guess the other alternative is you could just literally bypass all the stuff I was just doing and just go, I think it's this with the lock off. Yeah, you can just duplicate it. So if I want that again, oh crud. No. So if I wanted that, it's just duplicating the data and not the MIDI notes. So I could just like repeat sections of automation. And then honestly, the key for this stuff is just going like, that sounds dope. And then you go like, and then consolidate. Or no, sorry, freeze and flatten. Because then you can just start working with audio and it's the same every time. So you don't even have to worry about automation data. So this is what a lot of guys do, is you'll freeze, flatten, and then now you have like. And I could just take this section and just be like. And then I could further mess with it, you know what I mean? Now I could put like, I mean, this is gonna be ridiculous, but I could put like Isotope Trash 2 on it. And see what happens. Trash 2 is actually really cool for its convolve stuff. So I can put like an amp. Just gives you a different sonic. I But if you want to get really nuts, you can just like start going into presets and go into heavy and just be like. I mean, this is like when people are like, how'd you get that crazy sound? I'm like, you know, I usually just put trash on something and then just go like, okay, too much. And I'm like. But what's cool is you could just take that thing and maybe like either freeze and flatten it or take like an audio channel and go, you know, from Serum, mute it so you don't have to hear it, but you could just be like. And you can even just flip through presets like this and just be like. So like, I'm not going to use that whole thing, but what I could do is then go back to that recording, and because like in that last one, I really liked this one sound. It could just be, like this could be a fill. So you could take this, and it could be like, you know. It was like, no, I'm like trying to do like a generic. You know what I mean? Like that's your fill. And if you like, if that's too bombastic, you can put like, you know, I use this EQ all the time. Oh, not that. And you can just like, you know, do one of these. And even like make it super stereo. So maybe in this one moment, you're like, you want a little fill. So you go, oops, sorry, let me turn off trash. Also, it recorded all of these changes by accident because I left this on, but. You know what I mean? That's just like, for me, fills 101. It's just like taking stuff, distorting it, seeing what happens. Even this stuff, like you could just have like. That could even be a section of this, like after that transition, it could go into like. You know, this little fill happens and say, and you're in a different section, you know? And that's the beauty of using audio is then all of a sudden you have all this perfectly in, you know, locked in. And then go back to the other one here, you know, like. So then you have, you know, your A's and B sections and your fills. So yeah, I would actually, I would go back on myself and say, instead of, unless you like doing the automation copying and, you know, dragging around, just freeze it and then you take these little sections of audio and you get to mess with it. Because then also you can go even further in craziness and be like, I'm going to take this and pitch it down 12. Or, you know what I mean? Or up 12. And that could be a cool section, you know what I mean? After this whole. So then your sonic possibilities become endless. But the true origin of it is getting experimental with Serum and messing with complex waveforms or, you know, harmonically rich synths and then affect them. have fun messing with parameters, freeze them, distort them more. So like to go into, Ollie asked about my song with Puppet called Boy and the Beast. And like, that's what we did. We just like kept making sounds, distorting them, adding reverb, distorting them, doing other crazy stuff, and then like mess with audio. And I can show you to just kind of finish off the class with that, because I know he asked to see it. I'm just going to call this the old class D and B. So, any questions about anything we went over? Was that, like, do you guys feel more comfortable using that? I know I didn't really, like, explain that much, but I hope by, like, watching it, you got some ideas. I also, to be fair, have no idea what I'm doing. I just play around.
I have a question, Pierce. Yeah. Do you know if I really liked that sound in Ableton Wavetable where you used sample and hold as an LFO? Do you think there's a way you could do that in Logic?
You could definitely do it in FM8. I'm sure. I can actually check in Logic real quick. Juan, you're muted.
Sorry, I meant Serum. Sorry.
Oh, in Serum. Yeah, what was I doing again? I was modulating the cutoff with sample and hold.
It was just the LFO was basically like a randomized LFO. Yeah. It was just like a, yeah.
That's a pretty common, I mean, it depends on what synth you're using, but that's a pretty common LFO source because it's like, back in the day, that was the form of like randomization, which is, they call it sample and hold, which means just like a value just randomly selected and held like a square wave. And when you listen to it, it's actually really wild sounding. It's like, it's kind of like this digital noise. Yeah, let me see really quick. You wanted to see in Serum specifically?
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, so you actually, I know exactly how you can. The only downside with it is that it's going to be like a digital recreation of it. So let me really quickly go like this. So in Serum, X for records, Serum. Now I want to make drum and bass. So what's really cool is you can actually hold, I think you can hold, oh crud, come on. There's a way where you can, oh yeah, if you hold shift, you can just create random values in like a, you know, flat little, depending on your grid. So like this is technically like a looping sample and hold. So if you were to use this as like, you know, say I, it's just pretty short. And then like on something like Wavetable, it was probably like endlessly random. And you could technically probably achieve that. I don't really know how. Maybe if you increase the grid and like if you did like, so this is going to be like a more complex one. And then maybe there's a way to change the phase with another LFO so that it's constantly starting in different values, you know? Yeah, so if I go like this and then...
Does he have to share sound? Can you guys hear that?
Whoops, that's my bad again. As usual.
Man, holding shift in Serum does a lot more than I thought. Like, I watched a video on it not too long ago, and there's so many hotkeys for Serum that I had no idea existed.
Yeah, he really put a lot of thought into this plugin. It's really cool. That's why, like, I don't really use it that much, but I love having fun with it because it's so creative and, like, you know, I should do what I just did in that drum and bass idea more. I just, for some reason, never really think to go there because, I don't know, that's not usually how my music sounds, but it's very, and I like that it helped me understand concepts on other synthesizers much better. Logic, I don't know why, but Ableton, when you switch audio devices, takes like a second. And my Logic, whenever I change like the output device or the buffer size, it takes like a solid minute and a half. So, here we go. All right. You can hear that now? In beautiful, clear stereo audio. Perfect. So I think the way that this would be kind of like that sample and hold source would be if it's on off, And then it'd be really cool if there was a way to adjust like these values to be random. I don't really know. This is the best to my knowledge. I would have to tinker with it more, Will, but this is like the best I could get for a sample and hold, but I would want it to change like a little bit more. Cause honestly, what's, you know, actually where it might be handy is going into MIDI effects and going to modulator, because this is like truly a, this, so I've shown you this before, right? So you can go into sample and hold, and this is like a true sample and hold. You know, you see what I mean? It's different values. And then if you go, it's a little annoying because you have to use like outside plugins, but you could be like learn plugin parameter, and then all of a sudden you have a sample and hold on that. So now I can increase the rate and be like, and now actually both are messing with it, which is kind of cool. So it's like double randomization. And then you start to get, so remember I told you guys like noise FM? This is kind of like the same thing. Listen, it's just going crazier. So if I like change the output level, I think. Yeah, so you can achieve it with outside help. It would be cool if there was a way to do it in this where it was like a kind of more analog feeling random. Aha! I forgot that there's this section, chaos. So if I bypass this, if you go, I think you have to, so this is where the matrix becomes helpful. You can go into global and hit sample and hold and choose a rate. Go to the matrix and go source, chaos 2, which we just decided is sample and hold. You can go amount, destination, filter, cutoff. So now that is a random, you can just, so now it's truly a random sample and hold. And you can make it like this. You can make it go back and forth. Actually, it doesn't make sense to go back and forth. Does that help you, your question?
I'm going to use it all the time.
Sweet, yeah. This kind of stuff is really cool if you... It's really cool when you can quantize it, because you can have like a beat going in 120, and if it's going like, so that's where this one might come in more handy. So like, let me bypass this. Go back to this. And if I just had like, you start to get this kind of nice like progression based on just a sample and hold doing the filter. And what's cool is this is similar like to the Max for Live one, where it's just going to happen on a random phase every time, so you get different results every time. And so like if you did this, and then just for the sake of, I'm just going to find a little quick drum thing to make it sound cool. I want to show you guys a new cool plugin that I got. It's called Skaka. Check this thing out. It is a shaker plugin. So you can like customize shakers really quickly and really easily. So like if I just take this one MIDI clip and so like that's hitting one shaker, but check out what you can do. So this is like the main shaker. You can change it to like an egg, to a gungaroos, whatever that is, those seeds. But then you can change like the hits. You can humanize it, make it kind of sloppy. You can change the pitch. And what's sick is you can have like multiple ones going on at once. So let me put on like three of them. So if I want to like lower this one a little bit, I like a tambourine. Oh, it's this one, sorry. So you have just a nice, quick little progression. Yeah, I love doing this type of modulation, Will, so I'm glad you brought it up. Because you can just get like instant, in-time, cool patterns. So now if we have a kick, that's not distorted. And then check this out. If you wanted to like really start getting crazy, you could do like up a like fifth, I think. And they're all going to have different inflections because they kind of are random. Or you could do a different rate. Like you could be like, kind of sounds weird, but not only that basis. Oh, and you can smooth it on this, which is nice. You see how it gets. Maybe or we could do what we were just talking about, like add some FM stuff. Give it some harmonic interesting stuff. I like the spectral, those were kind of fun. Nope, we don't want to hear So you suddenly have a nice little jammer. And we can even use another new plugin that I got that I think is so funny. Check this out. It's just called Hats. And you just get hats. So if you're just like in a pinch and you need some hats, just take your kick pattern. And very quickly you can just be like. Even like we could do kind of sample and hold stuff with that. Like you can go into this mod, because these little MIDI effects are basically just like components of Serum that are just readily available right here. So like I could take, I didn't mean to do that. I could take the same concept, sample and hold, slower rate, and go to learn plugin parameter and go to like the decay. I guess it'd be. So now you have a random hat kind of opening and closing. Which is nice. And let's add like a ferocious tambourine this time so we get some more groove. Let's see. Or this calabash. So, yes, you can sample and hold in various ways. And I'm glad I actually learned the chaos one, because there's also other cool parts of that chaos section. Like, I don't even know what these other options are, but one day I will discover them. So, there's some hidden stuff in the back. All right. Let me quickly show Ollie some of the Boy and the Beast stuff. Otherwise, I'd feel like a real jerk for just stringing along. So, this project is, we did it between two different computers, so I only have one section of the song. I think we did the first slower drop on his computer, and then I like pulled it all over and mixed it somewhere. We mixed it at his house or something, but I have the last drop, so I hope that's the one you're more curious about. But I can tell you, it was mostly, we used to use Nexus a lot, so there was one, like the main lead is a Nexus sound that he found that we just kind of started messing with, and then where it gets kind of interesting is we did a lot of glide stuff, or maybe even just like automation kind of glide stuff. I'll have to check when I open it, but and then yeah, this one, the project name is called Something Distorted, because like what I was just doing with that drum bass project, I was just like distorting stuff, seeing what happens, and then we would just kind of like keep making ideas. And without further ado, we also have we have an element of this song, a channel called Spicy Ramen on a Hot Afternoon. That's what we decided to call our lead sound, I think.
What?
Yeah, I don't know.
It's oddly specific.
Yeah. This was back when we were just a couple of hooligans. So yeah, I don't have the full project. I have like the old intro that we had. Sorry, there's a lot of stuff that's out of whack. And so like to give you an example, all of these things that you're hearing are bounced audio from like sounds we were messing with. So like you can see this is like a heavily clipped, like look at this stuff, that's all the meow. So like to show you where it came from, the drop, and this kind of goes back to what we've been doing today, the drop sounds like this. Oh my god, it's really loud. Is it really loud for you guys? Let me turn it down a little bit. So, you can hear a lot of stuff going on. The main bass sound is this spicy ramen on a half afternoon, apparently. And this, I think, is this synth, which is massive, apparently. Oh no, that must have been a layer that we just muted. I forget what the actual synth was for that. Oh, I guess it was this. Spire. Yeah, with like Sausage Fattener in. So I guess it's just some... I mean, you guys saw in some of my other projects, I used to just like go through Spire and find presets, and I was like, cool. But with all these effects on, it's just like a heavy saw noise. That's really it. That's the one thing that's nice about Spire is they have like interesting sounding noise. I don't know what it is. Or maybe it's, I don't know. Yeah, I don't really know what's going on, but it just has a nice quality to it. So we did that, and I think we bounced it to audio because it was like kind of problematic just leaving it out. And I think we wanted the same articulation every time. And then we added like ridiculous processing. And so it's similar to like a lot of the other songs that I used to work on from this era. Like, apparently we have that bass also in the bass line where I just used to layer basses. So like there's this call and response type thing. So it's like, you know, another Nexus bass. And this is back when I used to like put sample delay on my basses because I was like, meh, sounds cool. Even though it's not technically like a good thing to do. But if you cut the lows, you're not really running into too much issue with phase. It's just more of a like add to the body of the sound. Because like if you listen to this section without that, now that you guys can hear in stereo, it just kind of brings it back to the center. And I like having one layer that's like on the outside. So yeah, it's like a layer of Nexus, this crazy growly Spire preset. Yeah, typically I do this, I find leads and then just play them like an octave or two down and they sound like really nice tonal basses, not so much like thumpy basses. So that's a layer with OTT and compression. This noise bass that I used to use in all my songs. And then a sub, just in my old way of layering a bunch of basses. And then I believe Brendan actually wrote the lead, because I don't remember doing any of this. But it has, as you can see, Homicide, Reverb, Sausage Fattener, Bit Crusher, Space Designer, Reverb, Stereo stuff, Kickstart. So apparently we just like abused the sound. Like, let's see without all this stuff on it. It sounds pretty similar. I don't know what preset it is. Apparently it's called Bathroom Rocker. Oh boy, who came up with that name? Sounds like a bad experience in the bathroom. But then when you throw like Homicide, it starts to get these kind of distorted overtones. And then we, you know, naively use space sample delay, which sounds dope, but technically is not very good for mono compatibility. But... And then he did all this like kind of delicate automation stuff. Let's see. Oh no, this is an old trick I used to do where you put on like glide and then you just put the notes like after where you want it to change and then kind of like time it. So like if I had made it like here, it would be like. But if you just like mess with the settings of both the glide and when you put the next note, because like if I make it shorter, it sounds like this. So it's just about finding that little sweet spot. And then this stuff is just like, I think he did all this. And then there's clearly some pitch automation going. Yeah, yeah, so I remember he did this stuff. So maybe I did the glide and then he, I don't know, whatever. But I remember he added the pitch bend stuff in the automation data, which is what made it kind of sound like bombastic and bizarre. So those are the main synth parts. It's like Nexus, Spire, and more Nexus. And then another thing that you guys have seen me do is I also did an instance of reverb that's heavily sidechained to that original signal so that it jumps out in the middle. And then you know what's funny is actually weirdly my favorite part of the song is not the drops, it's actually the like outro bit, this. Oh no, not that, sorry. Where is it? Can't see, let's see, is it here? Yeah, this stuff, I love this part. This all involved like what I was going over before, which is like distorting things, bouncing samples, and kind of like treating it individually. So like all those little elements were in this intro where it goes. So like these are like individual audio chops from that lead. But then we also have this cool little like background. And that's being sidechained, it seems like, to this stuff. So if I mute these, oh, it still goes. But if I turn off the, so it's actually the little pre-drop thing, which I forget how we even made that. I was trying to figure it out because it comes from, I think we made it on his computer because it comes from this audio file called Brendan Bits. But I remember we were kind of just like making ourselves laugh, distorting stuff. And then I was like, dude, this like thing that we made is actually really dope. This little pre-drop section thing. Yeah. So yeah, this was just the result of having fun with distortion, really. Ollie, do you have any specific questions about it, or is this helpful for you?
Not really. It was more just like how all the sounds were, I guess, made and like layered and stuff like that. So
I will tell you one cool trick, especially since you're a Logic user, is the first drop, that's like the slower one. I had made a version of the slow drop because I remember Brendan was like, I want to make it different for the first drop, not just the same. And I was like, all right. And I think I was just starting to use Alchemy from like Logic's version. And there's this preset called Future Junglist that I had made something that sounded kind of just like, it was just like one after the other. And he kind of took it and expanded it by using like all these different like, and if you mess with some of these settings, like the, or actually even, so it was just a preset that we just kind of messed with and changed the pitch, I think, somehow. Yeah. So this is like some sort of granular thing. Oh, apparently it's a drum loop. Oh, so clearly each hit is like a different starting point on a loop. So if you drag out the decay, you can hear the whole thing, or the sustain, sorry. But we used it as like kind of a, so that's why Alchemy is honestly like low key very, very cool to use, because you could just happen upon some, like you'll have sounds that are like this, like standard stuff. But like clearly I five-starred this, so let's see what it sounds like. Just some nice bells, you know? So it's a pretty cool synth. Just of, it's one of those ones that I seriously have no idea how it really works. I know that there's like four layers. It kind of reminds me of like an Omnisphere type synth, where it's a combination of like classic synthesis with kind of more advanced modes, like, you know, spectral stuff, additive stuff, formant stuff, but then it also incorporates samples. So I think this is like sample audio, but you can also just use like a standard waveform, I think. But yeah, it's a pretty complex synth and you can get cool sounds. I also like that you can flip through presets and quickly have all these variations. Let me turn my master back up. So, I mean, this is like how I, this is my sound design 101, is like find a weird sound, mess with it, see if I can resample it and distort it or something. But yeah, Alchemy's cool. And that's, yeah, so that Future Junglist is how we got that first drop, is we just messed with that a lot. And then the last drop is all these spires and such. And then honestly, like you guys have seen it 100 times, these are all like the same drums that I've used in like every song. I think even the same fills, like all this kind of stuff. Or just like different versions of the same pattern. So yeah, your standard old school Pierce Fulton drop with Puppet. Is there anything else you guys, based on just like what we've talked about, whether it's synthesis stuff or resampling, or like any last burning questions? No? As I always do with all my classes, just improvised, but was this, did you Did you get something out of it? That's all that matters. Because I like improvising, because I think if I plan too much, I feel like the little surprises are usually what's the most fun. And that, like, this is how I make my music. I'm not very, like, organized and planned. I kind of just mess around and then improvise based on, like, how a sound hits me. So I'd rather show you guys how I actually do it rather than, like, have some whole lesson plan mocked up stuff. You know, I kind of just, I mean, my technique is to just twist knobs and see what happens, basically. And when you know what those knobs do, it makes it a little more helpful. I don't even know all of them, as you guys saw with some of these plugins. I like, oh, yeah, that's that. And I like kind of hope to keep that level of like being naive, because there's something about it where you like, it makes it more fun. You get to surprise yourself. If you know everything like super well, you know, obviously there's a lot of advantages to that, but there's something kind of fun about the like idea of still being kind of a beginner in certain aspects and like not knowing everything. It's also hard to know all this stuff and then also be good at mixing and mastering and playing guitar and writing lyrics. You know what I mean? It's like, there's a lot of elements to writing a song. So I try and learn the best I can of everything, but yeah.